Hey YouTube, welcome to Tasmania. This week on our video, we're going on a tour of Wobbly Boot Vineyard in Campania. We're going to have a look around and see why and how they do what they do. Paul is going to take us on this tour and we can't wait to have a look.
So much heart and soul in this place.
Can't wait to taste the wine.
So we're at Wobbly Boot Vineyard and we're going to have a look around, and I think they're even going to give us a little tour.
Looking this way, the hills are very big. That's Butcher's Hill just behind Richmond. Right through there. This valley here, we've got the Cole River where those big gum trees are, and that joins our river, which is the White Kangaroo River. That one there.
Yes.
Does look like that, which borders our boundary. And that forms the outline of the property, the boot shaped outline. What we do. Vineyard at the front is Maeve's Block, named after our dog, who dug a lot of the hole. We planted these in January this year, so these are our babies out here. Today out here we've got the Sighthound Appreciation Society. We get a lot of hobby groups coming out here because we've fenced off a couple of the areas. Dog thrifted, so it's popular for people like this. And as you can see, they've been there, spread out, and the dogs run around. And this area here, we have little functions in here. We do cooking classes. Linda's a hospitality teacher.
Oh, okay, and, that's perfect.
So she's going to be doing some of the stuff that she learnt from when she was away in Turkey. The cooking classes are very much about people come in. We give them a glass of wine to start with, which is a bit of an icebreaker. Mm-hmm. And then we do the different things there, and there's some of it's dim, some of it's hands-on, but everyone likes to have a drink whilst they're cooking, so we incorporate that. And then during halfway through, we go out to the vines, have a glass out there, and we just sort of then make the connection between what's happening in the vineyard with what's in the glass.
Uh-huh.
And then at the end of it, whatever we're prepared with.
That's amazing.
Yeah, pretty.
What other styles of food have you done with them?
We've done dairy-free cheese-making classes.
What?
Yeah, we've got a bit of a vegan following, which has happened by accident.
Okay.
Because our wine, we don't use any animal products in the vining of our wine. People who use veganism, they found that out and they won't drink wines that got any animal products in them. They're very, very... Yeah, that's become an issue. And so we've teamed up with a lady, she runs a business called Veggielicious. So she does vegan cookery. So she's done dairy-free cheese making. She's also done vegan party food as well.
Oh wow.
Not too sure what's happening next year with that, but there'll be a few other classes that she will do as well. Yeah, so they're the cooking classes, and obviously the doggy thing is a really big thing for us, the animal welfare stuff. We've got our dog Christmas party next weekend. Our other events, we've had anywhere between 150 to 350 people and dogs. That's our giving tree. The small paws animal rescue. So people bring in foodstuffs and doggy and cat toys and all the rest of it.
That's so great.
When you've got this, this is what
we're gonna have a look at this.
We've got at least three resident platypus.
We know there's at least three. Because they're all different sizes, so it's not the same one we're seeing.
Yeah.
They're different sizes.
The river here, the ecosystem, pretty healthy. Yeah. We just can't get enough of it. Wind is worse than me because once she's out here, whether she's doing pruning or tucking in or searching or whatever, she won't stop.
It's good you have a job you love. That's,
yeah.
You know.
I never thought jobs that you love existed, because I was a teacher for a while and I was a social worker for a long time. Aww. And a couple of years ago we bought this place. They do exist. I can't wait to get to work each day. You come out here, you prune a vine, you've seen what you've done, you put a fence up, you can see what you've done.
You get to watch people enjoy it.
People tell you what your wine is like, which is you feel like Santa Claus half the time. And of course whatever you put in here is reflected in the glass. So the more time and the more love you put into this, that's what comes out.
Did you get that?
What made you want to buy a vineyard?
Linda and I, when we first met, we were studying. So Linda was doing teaching and I was studying social work. And in those days, what we used to do on the summer breaks is that we'd pack up our little old Corolla and we'd head into state with our tent. And we'd head to wine areas. So we'd go to Barossa or a Hunter or Clare or one of those areas, put the tent up, and we'd visit the wineries all day. After we graduated,
probably thought you had to work a bit
more money.
Yeah.
We then went international travel. Where would we go? France, Italy, wine.
Yeah, wherever the wine was.
Oh, geez. On vineyards and cellar door places and things. So it was inevitable that we would end up having our own one day, but it had to be the right place because it's all about site. You've got to have the proper place to grow your grapes. You can grow grapes just about anywhere, but if you want to grow something really special, you need the
right
era. Yeah. And we looked everywhere, all over Tassie, to get the right spot. This was the place that had the best fruit. The fruit that comes out of this vineyard, it's really full-flavoured wine, so it's not light and delicate, right? It's big and bold and fairly complex, which is the sort of styles we enjoy. We'll just have a little wander with your vines. The thing to do is give them the best organic things, keep the water up, check them daily so you can get the disease outbreak quickly. All those sort of things. Spend time and more time.
In your opinion, what makes a great grape?
Basically, giving them the best everything. We feed ours with help. As you can see, this is all not manicured underneath here with herbicide, and you'll see most vineyards will be white or yellow around there. That's because they've used glyphosate under there. The first year we did that because we just copied what was the practice that had been done before. The last 2 years I haven't done it, and I've found that my quality has not changed at all. Right. In fact, I think our quality is better. So I'm now wondering whether you need to do that at all, because it's always been done. Does that mean it's the right thing to do? Exciting time, because we've got flowering.
Where is that in the process? Fruit bearing and...
Yeah, what we've got at the moment, that's called inflorescence, when you've got these little white bits. And when we say flowering, it's not like a big flowery bud thing coming out. It's a tiny little white things there. And if we get days like this, we will get good pollination, which means each one of these will be a grape and a bunch, right?
if we get cold and wet and windy, which we've actually had a bit of a lot of it, yeah, we won't get good pollination, which means we'll either get half this bunch will pollinate, one third of it, or whatever. So you can imagine across a vineyard, your yield will be affected. That's why I said it's critical the next couple of weeks. Growing grapes in Tasmania is on the edge. The next week's good, so we should be okay. We go through winter, we do all the pruning. Then in spring, we've got about 10 weeks of hoping that we don't get frost. Now, this whole zone through the Coal Valley is frosty. If you just get a normal frost, these will get burnt.
Yeah, okay.
So,
have you lost much?
Not last year, the year before, we lost a few down in this corner here.
Yeah.
But you can, if you get a bad frost, you can lose 80% overnight.
That's
to deal with. The other thing which is significant is disease, and the diseases here in Tassie are powdery mildew and downy mildew. Unless you check your vines daily, you can't go away for a holiday for a week, you come back, it'll be too late. What you get on peas and tomatoes and a few other things. Gets on the leaves, it's not too much of a problem, but when it gets into here, your fruit is accurate. And the only way you can do it is check. So we actually go and check our vines almost daily. All the winemaker wants is the same as what a chef wants, which is the best ingredients. The chef will get the best ingredients that makes them look good. Winemakers are the same. They want the A-plus grade fruit, and then it's minimal intervention. All he has to do... And Lance says, I don't need to do anything with the chef, I just ferment.
Yeah. You only sell here and online, is that right?
We have a wine club, which is people who've been here like our wine, and they buy our wine every 6 months. We have a couple of restaurants that we sell to. Well, they are Peacock and Jones. Parliament House has our wine. A Loft, which is above Glass House, has our wine, and that's it. The sheep, I'll just mention the sheep because you were interested in not using herbicide. For about 6 months of the year, we have the sheep are in the vineyard. So what the sheep do, the sheep go up the rows, and of course they're eating all the grass and all the weeds, so there's your weed management, so you don't need to use a herbicide. And the other thing they're doing is they're fertilising at the same time. So win-win. These ones here in the middle are Savoie. If you're back here in a couple of months' time, you're going to have, the Sauv Blancs are going to all have fruit on them. Now, when we do the picks here, and we do a, people have been involved in the vineyard, right? We get them all down here and they do the pick. When you taste the grapes, and then you taste the wine, the grapes off here taste what's in the glass. It's the same, right? And
is that hard to come across? Is that like, well, that's a very good process of wine making?
Yeah.
Or is it actually just...
It should taste.
It suggests to me that there's minimal processing,
exactly.
Minimal...
Yeah, intervention. That's right. It should taste what's here in the glass. People are often surprised because they'll say that they've had wine grapes and it's nothing like the finished product. But that's because it's been processed. All sorts of things have had happen to it. You're going to get a little bit of a change with the Pinot because that goes into barrels, so you've got a little bit of an oak influence there. But our Pinot here, when you tasted it right when it's ripe, it tastes like blueberries. Right through. And you just gorge on it.
It's so sweet.
This valley, so quiet, it's got the river around it. All the grasses and the weeds here are serving a purpose. The clover, for example, here is what's called a nitrogen fixer. So that's actually the leaves of the clover is and into the root system is actually putting nitrogen back into the soil, right? Which is like a fertilizer. So we don't want to kill any of these things here. The other thing that's going on is you've got a whole ecosystem under the vines with insects and so on, and you know they're doing all their good things as well. So, but it doesn't look manicured and pretty.
And we like that.
And we love that. Yeah.
And the sporadic dog toys also serve a purpose.
unreal that this place is in Tasmania and we haven't been here before. And how many more places are there that are like this? And I guess that's why we're making these videos, that we get to go and see the beauty that is here and meet the people that are passionate about what they're doing.
Here it comes.
Okay, guys.
Thank you.
Hey, Willow.
Oh, he's our first pup. Bye, Willow.
I think Willow's got a better offer.
Oh, thank you.
So what you're having is the 16th Blanc just in front of you is where that wine comes from. Last year's vintage, that was the end of March. The Pinot is from the end row, and that's the 2015. That has been in oak barrels for 9 months.
Oh, thank you so much. That's really fun. Enjoy this. Come right. Back in and see you when we're...
Yeah, okay.
Isn't he the best? Aaron is his element.
Double barreled.
We have a newsletter that goes out every 6 months or so, which basically the events that we have here. We use the social media to advertise things.
What is your social media?
We use Facebook, we use Twitter, Pinterest, and Instagram. And we find that all of them have different audiences. We also use print media as well.
So what did we do? We just finished up?
Oh, we just had the most delightful afternoon in Wobbly Boot Vineyard. And we got the full tour. We recommend if you come to Wobbly Boot, ask Paul and Linda about their wine, about their whole process, about everything from the very beginning, because the wine will taste so much better. Not that it needs to have any extra spice to it, because it's amazing.
It just means so much more when you see that these vineyard vines just here are in the bottles of wine that Beck is holding. When you know that's all in there, it tastes so much better. We're gonna drive home now and then get started on putting this video together.